tiny build, a place to save a couple grams, especially with a small plane like this, is to use lighter servo wire than standard servo wire you get with, you know, your servos and receivers. And for this build, I use some wire from Power Box Systems. You can buy this in 50-foot lengths, and this is a high strand count copper wire with a very light jacket on it, so it's less than half the weight of standard servo wire. And I use this in the wings. Now, to run back from the ESC to the receiver, I use an alternative, and this is actually cable that I took out of an old USB cable that had failed. And computer cables are a pretty good source for finding lightweight wire. It's got a fairly decent strand count. It is copper. Is it easy to solder? Only drawback is that the coating is pretty heat sensitive, and it'll melt back a little bit when you're trying to solder it if you don't do a really fast solder job. But if you're looking for some cheap light wire, USB cables are a pretty good source for that. So setting up the flaperons took a little bit of engineering. I didn't really have any other planes to go by, so I was just kind of inventing it myself. You can either do a top drive, where it's going through the wing skin and hooking into a horn on the top side of the flaperon surface, or easier, maybe not as clean, but you could do a bottom drive system too, just old school, and just run a push rod straight from the servo, straight back to a horn. You could use the same horn that came with the kit at the flap line and just do it that way. And but I decided to do the complicated top drive way. It's a little bit cleaner aerodynamically. You can see the servo here. Basically what you have to do is there's a carbon skin covering this. You just use a sharp knife and score that out. It comes right off pretty easily. And then you want to cut out the foam out of the square. And I just slice it these directions here and just pick it out with a screwdriver, or like an awl like this, but a screwdriver works pretty well, like a flat blade. Now for the top drive, we actually have to have the push rod come at a fairly shallow angle, go through the foam here. Actually, we're going through the foam spar on the wing. You would think, oh, that's really going to affect the strength of the wing, but the spar on this wing is really not doing much. It's a stress skin with a foam core here, and that's what's really taking a lot of the structural load. So it's not a big deal to punch a small hole for the push rod to go through. So it goes through a shallow angle through the spar, and then pokes out the skin on the other side, and then connects to the flaperon horn on the top surface here. So I just had to figure out where the angle was. So as the push rod went through its travel, it didn't contact the top skin here or get any interference with the spar. I kind of wanted to go through right through the middle of the spar and then back towards the horn. And this is where the servo ended up, almost square dead center in the pocket here. So the basic spar kind of runs in this area here. You can see where the push rod goes through the spar at one small point, so that hole is only a couple millimeters wide. Now to glue the servo to the wing skin, I used glue. I wrapped this a couple of times in Kapton tape. You could use masking tape as well, but Kapton's pretty clean. And also the glue I'm using, which is E6000, is kind of like shoe goo. It's a urethane-based glue. A little dab of that, and that glued it really well to the skin, and it adheres really well to the Kapton tape. So if I need to get the servo out, I just cut the tape and I can pop the servo out. So that's pretty old school, but it works pretty well if you're not using a servo frame. And then for the linkage to the horn, I actually had some Thomas Louis from Hong Kong. He makes these really nice clevis pins. I had a whole bunch left over from the Orion build a couple of months back. So I decided to use that. It's really tight. It's robust. It's never going to break. And it glues really well to the carbon push rod here. Now the servo does stick up above the wing skin a little bit. If you push the servo back, you'll get a little bit more clearance, but what happens is you'll get interference of the push rod. You know, even if I use just a wire Z-bend connection here, I would still get interference and would start hitting the bottom skin. So, you know, setting a servo up like this is always a little bit of a trade-off, but this works well. There's plenty of clearance between the clevis and the servo. Everything's nice and straight, and there's no interference on any part of the system. So this is a good compromise. I get plenty of throw here. I did angle back the horn on the servo and use the subtrims so I can maximize my flap travel, because we want a lot of down, which is pushing this direction, but we don't need a lot of up pulling this direction. So for the wiring, I just tunneled a the foam out with this scratch awl back to here. This is, there's a point here between where the spar is. This is the plug-in area for the where the spar on the other wing half plugs into. And there's just enough space here to punch a hole. And I just, you know, pulled the foam out, ran the wire through, fished it out. This is just a standard servo connector. Because this is a high strain sort of item here, if we're going to be taking the wing on and off a lot. It's got the, you know, heat shrink on it, of course, but also wrapped it in some black heavy duty thread just to kind of tie everything together, and then coated it in two coats of that liquid electrical tape stuff that rubberizes when it hardens. So this is nice and strong now. It has plenty of strain relief. And even if you take your wing on and off for every flight, it should last a long time and you won't have any failures at this point. So here's a detail of the top drive. You can see the horn is sunk into the flaperon surface. And the hole for the flaperon push rod is kind of right above the hinge line there. And a little bit of an old school connection for the carbon push rod. I just made a L-bend, a piece of music wire, L-bend, CA'd to the rod. And then over that is some heat shrink with more CA. And then you heat shrink it down with a CA going off inside, and it makes a really nice connection between the push rod and the L-bend piece of metal. And there's a little bit of a keeper on the end of that L-bend, some small heat shrink, just to keep it into the horn, even though there's really nowhere it can go. And you can see it has just a small slot in the top wing surface where that rod comes out at a pretty shallow angle. And not too hard to do. The hardest part was just determining where that slot was going to be. Once I had the foam pulled out and had the push rod kind of poke through from the servo bay, I could kind of see where it was hitting the skin as it was traveling towards the horn. So just took some measuring, some tape, just to make sure that, you know, the rod would line up to the horn. And you can kind of see where it was pushing through the skin, and then just cut my slots there. I'll see if I can include some dimensions on this for you if you want to do a top drive system. I have the servo powered up, and let's do one direction, so that's up aileron or flaperon. Here's down aileron or flaperon. And then here's full flaps. You can see at full travel, the edge of the clevis just clears the back edge of the servo cutout. That's what you're looking for. I did get the optional ballast kit, and this kit was originally designed for the DLG version, but I did a quick and simple mod to get this to work with the Electro, and I'll show you how I did it. They're basically just 10-gram weights. They slide on the stainless steel wire here, and you want to set it up so the weights are over the CG. I don't like to change my CG when adding ballast. If I fly neutral, I like the airplane to stay neutral. Some people like to have the CG move a little far forward for windy conditions, but I'll add nose weight if I want to dampen out some turbulence. Anyway, you slide them down, you CA them on the rod, and then you slip them into the fuse, slide them down, and clip them in. So let me show you the mod I made to allow this ballast system to work with the Electro. Now on the Vortex 3 DLG, there's actually a crossbar at the end of the cockpit, which goes across, and then this clips slides down into a hole in that crossbar, and it clips itself into place. But we need this room back here to slide the battery in, and for our F5K Altus tracker. So I came up with this solution. I just drilled a little bigger hole in the side of the servo tray here. And then you just put the ballast stick in, slide it back, and then just plug it into the hole and push it down. Kind of locks itself in place. It clears the cable by a fair distance here and stays out of the way. And the cool thing is, because I did this on the other side as well, so I can clip in a second stick of ballast too, so I can have like 2 1-ounces or 2 2-ounces, something like that. And there are enough weights in this kit to make a wide variety of ballast setups for your flying needs. So this white paint mark here is my 70 millimeter, kind of my neutral point for the CG on the plane. You can see the sticks are lining up symmetrical to that mark, and that's what you want. You know, having a CG a couple millimeters more forward is fine, but you just don't want to have the CG fall behind that mark to make the plane too pitch neutral, because you're going to have a handful if you have the heavier plane, but with the two neutral CGs. So a little far forward is okay, but try to get the weights to fall right at your good flying CG. And I would make the sticks after you actually know that CG. Depending on your flying style, that might be more forward, and for some guys, it might be further back. One trick I just figured out is to bend the wire, this arm part, towards the servo, towards the center line of the airplane. Makes it easier to clear the cable when you're taking the ballast in and out.